This is an extract from the book The Age of Responsibility, CSR 2.0 and the New DNA of Business by Wayne Visser, read by the author. Chapter 4, The Age of Marketing. Case 3, John Brown and BP. On the 1st of May 2007, John Brown resigned as CEO of BP after 41 years with the company and 12 years at its helm. According to BBC business editor Robert Peston, it was a sad end to what was, until recently, a distinguished career. The reason for his resignation, a year ahead of plan, was the imminent publication by a British tabloid of details about his homosexuality, and the fact that he lied to the courts about his relationship. That something so private, which should have been a mere footnote in Brown's biography, prematurely ended his career, is a sad indictment of the bigoted times we still live in. Be that as it may, John Brown's story is interesting not because of his personal life, but rather his very public life during a time of great change and challenge at BP. How Brown came to be at BP in the first place was really thanks to his father, who worked for Anglo-Persian Oil, which later became British Petroleum. While Brown was studying physics at Cambridge University, and at the suggestion of his father, he began as an apprentice with BP in 1966. Needless to say, he never left, working his way up the ranks and holding various posts, such as Group Treasurer of BP Finance International, Chief Financial Officer of BP America, CEO of Standard Oil Production Company, and finally Group CEO in 1995. His takeover date is important because it was the same year that Shell was being heavily criticized for its proposed sinking of the Brent Spar oil platform in the North Atlantic, as well as its alleged complicity with the Nigerian government in the execution of human rights activist Ken Sarawiwa. Brown would have taken special note of former Shell UK chairman's warning that the days when companies were judged solely in terms of economic performance and wealth creation have disappeared. For us, he said, Brent Spar was the key turning point. It was a wake-up call, not only to Shell, but to the entire oil and gas industry, and to industry in general. Indeed, Brown would have been all too aware of a few skeletons in BP's own closet at the time, most notably the fact that between 1993 and 1995, BP's contractor, Doyen Drilling, was engaged in illegally dumping hazardous wastes on Endicott Island in Alaska, injecting it down the outer rim of the oil wells. When BP learned of the practice and failed to report it to the authorities, it contravened the so-called US Superfund legislation. After a few years of legal wrangling, in 1999, BP agreed to a settlement of $22 million, which included a criminal fine of $500,000, which was the maximum, and $6.5 million in civil penalties, and BP's establishment of a $15 million environmental management system at all BP's facilities in the US and Gulf of Mexico that were engaged in oil exploration, drilling, or production. Another skeleton was the allegations in 1996 of complicity of human rights abuses in Colombia. It was a seminal lesson for Brown, as he later recalled, saying, BP entered that country seeking a tantalizing prize of rich resources amidst violent insurrection, a polarized society, and dark undercurrents in politics. Clearly, security was a challenge, but we assumed that we had the answer, a thick barbed wire fence with security personnel, and if necessary, the help of the Colombian army. What we hadn't realized was that a fence keeps you in as well as others out. BP's presence, in particular the payment of an unfortunately named dollar per barrel war tax, was viewed as giving tacit support to a brutal military regime in which human rights were being trampled underfoot. For the first time, I realized that the company's brand, its reputation, and ultimately its value had been laid on the line because of our failure to fully appreciate our human rights responsibilities. Brown also inherited BP's membership of the Global Climate Coalition, a powerful lobby group created in 1989, shortly after the UN created the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. The Global Climate Coalition actively attempted to undermine emerging climate science and to derail international policy development. To his credit, Brown withdrew BP's membership in 1997. In a groundbreaking speech at Stanford University, he stated that the time to consider the policy dimensions of climate change is not when the link between greenhouse gases and climate change is conclusively proven, but when the possibility cannot be discounted and is taken seriously by the society of which we are a part. We in BP have reached that point. As Petroleum Economist, the publication, put it, BP had left the church. Within the space of a few years, step by step, Brown began to transform the image of BP. One of the great watershed moments was in 1998, when Brown threw down the gauntlet to BP and to the oil industry, promising to cut emissions from its own operations by 10% from 1990 levels by 2010, which was more than the average Kyoto Protocol country targets and certainly more than any other major oil company had committed to until that time. In fact, they achieved the target 4 years later, 8 years ahead of the target, and at no net cost to the company. Brown seemed to be doing and saying everything right, and was slowly but surely becoming the darling of environmentalists that were desperate for signs of reform among the big brands. One crucial tool was public reporting. BP, having merged with Amoco at the end of 1998, issued their first environmental and social report in 1999. In his CEO statement, Brown made encouraging statements like, "The environment is the primary challenge facing the industry," and "There is no trade-off between our commercial and financial performance and our standards of care." To reassure the market analysts, he promised, and I quote, "to apply to our performance in these areas with the same rigor we apply to the delivery and reporting of our financial performance, measuring, setting targets as part of an overall performance contract, and reporting openly on how we have done, using independent external auditing and verification processes where possible." I can, to a certain extent, attest to those words as not being just flowery statements, as KPMG had been working with BP in helping to design an internal carbon emissions trading scheme, a progressive step for any company, let alone an oil major. By 2000, Brown felt the company had earned enough public kudos to risk a major rebranding of BP. The company reportedly spent $7 million in researching the new Beyond Petroleum Helios brand and $25 million on a campaign to support the brand change. When Brown justified the exercise by saying, "It's all about increasing sales, increasing margins, and reducing costs at retail sites," perhaps more people should have been tempered in their expectations. Certainly Greenpeace wasn't duped, concluding at the time that this is a triumph of style over substance. BP spent more on their logo this year than they did on renewable energy last year. To make their point explicit, Greenpeace ran a counter campaign using the same design as the BP adverts, but adding the following text. "We also harness greenwash. Seen our ads on TV and in the press, impressed that we've finally got the message on climate change? Think again. We're also running a big advertising campaign in the US. Both versions have the same graphics, the same nifty tune, the same style. But whereas the Brits are told to work out your carbon footprint, it's a start. The American consumer is told, we're investing $15 billion in finding new oil and gas in the Gulf of Mexico. It's a start." The author of The Tyranny of Oil is similarly skeptical, claiming that at its peak, BP was spending 4% of its total capital and exploratory budget on renewable energy, and that this has since declined, despite Brown's announcement in 2005 of BP's plans to double investment in alternative and renewable energies. Brown said it was to create a new low-carbon power business with the growth potential to deliver revenues of around $6 billion a year within the decade. Skeptics notwithstanding, Brown had earned his new title as the Sun King, and his reputation was not only being earned with green stripes. BP was also one of the first companies to declare their support for the Publish What You Pay campaign. However, after BP decided unilaterally to publish the value of taxes paid to the Angolan government, the state-owned oil partner, Sonangol, accused the company of breaking confidentiality clauses in its agreements and threatened to terminate its contracts. As a result, under advice from Brown, the UK's Blair government launched the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative in 2002 at the World Summit for Sustainable Development in Johannesburg. This was to tackle the so-called resource curse and to ensure the verification and full publication of company payments and government revenues from oil, gas, and mining. Success or failure is all about timing. If Brown had been a politician and had retired in 2003 after 2 4-year terms of office, he may still have been covered in glory, with his Sun King crown still firmly in place. After all, he had turned BP into an oil major, perhaps even a competitor for ExxonMobil, by creating a lean, mean, green machine. Instead, he hung on to power long enough to face the consequences of his own legacy of cost-cutting and rhetoric. As a result, between 2004 and 2007, the proverbial chickens came home to roost. Brown was left tarred and feathered. While Brown had clearly prioritized environmental issues from the start, he had reason to be less nervous about health and safety risks. The last really serious BP incident had been in 1965, when Britain's first offshore oil rig, the Sea Gem, had capsized, killing 13 crew members. But that complacency, if indeed it existed, all changed on the 23rd of March 2005, when an explosion and fire at BP's Texas City refinery killed 15 workers and injured more than 170 others. An investigation into the accident by the Occupational Safety and Health Administration ultimately found over 300 safety violations and fined BP $21 million, the largest fine in the institution's history at the time. The story did not end there. In 2007, in a separate settlement related to the explosion, BP pleaded guilty to a violation of the Federal Clean Air Act and agreed to pay a $50 million fine and to make safety upgrades to the plant. Complying with the terms of the Occupational Safety and Health Administration settlement was also a condition of the Justice Department agreement. Blast victims challenged the plea deal, arguing that the fine was trivial in light of BP's $22 billion profits in 2006. 2 years later, in 2009, a fine was imposed of $80 million, claiming that the company had not completed all the safety upgrades required under the agreement and alleging 439 new willful safety violations. Predictably, BP announced its contestation of the fine. A few months after the Texas explosion, BP's Thunder Horse semi-submersible oil platform in the Gulf of Mexico almost became fully submersible after Hurricane Dennis hit. The rig had been evacuated before the storm, so no one was injured, and when the platform was restabilized, no serious damage had been incurred. However, during repairs, it was discovered by chance that the underwater manifold was severely cracked due to poor welding pipes. While this was not the cause of the platform's instability, the rig's design engineer admitted that it could have caused a catastrophic oil spill. In March 2006, BP was not so lucky when it was found to be criminally liable for a corroded pipe on Alaska's North Slope that leaked 200,000 gallons of oil. In August the same year, another leak appeared and the entire Prudhoe Bay operation had to be shut down. During the investigation, a federal grand jury subpoenaed records from a Seattle engineering firm that had been hired by Alaska to evaluate BP's pipeline maintenance record and uncovered a draft report that was highly critical of BP, but somehow turned into a final report that was largely complimentary. Member of Congress, Republican Jay Inslee, concluded that BP had made a willful, conscious decision to quash that information from the public. By the time of Brown's undignified exit into the wings of BP history in 2007, he was widely criticised for the dual crimes of greenwashing and instilling a cost-cutting culture that was the root cause of BP's spate of safety and environmental incidents. Even the new CEO, Tony Hayward, a year before taking over, admitted that BP had a management style that had made a virtue of doing more for less. In an ironic twist of fate, in June 2010, Brown was appointed Efficiency Tsar by the new British coalition government and tasked with finding £6.2 billion, or $9.9 billion, worth in spending cuts. Less than a month later, one of the first casualties was the government's Sustainable Development Commission, shut down on the same day that the agency released its annual report, showing tens of millions of pounds worth of saving from cutting fuel, water, waste, and other resources as a result of its actions in government. After taking over, Hayward quickly showed that he was not one for green rhetoric. Less than 6 months into the job, he announced BP's plans to invest nearly £1.5 billion, or $2.3 billion, to extract oil from the Canadian wilderness, the so-called Alberta tar sands, an action which earned it a Guardian newspaper headline as the biggest environmental crime in history. Greenpeace claims that it takes about 29 kilograms of carbon dioxide to produce a barrel of oil conventionally, but as much as 125 kilograms for tar sands oil. It also believes the production threatens a vast forest wilderness, greater than the size of England and Wales, which forms part of one of the world's biggest carbon sinks. 2 years later, Hayward's apparent back-to-petroleum strategy gained momentum when BP announced that it had shut down its alternative energy headquarters in London, accepted the resignation of its clean energy boss, and imposed cuts in the alternative energy budget from $1.4 billion, or £850 million, in 2008 to between $500 million and $1 billion in 2009. Bizarrely, Hayward used this occasion to stress that BP remained as committed as ever to exploring new energy sources. No wonder grist journalist Joseph Rom responded with an incredulous rant. Seriously, they gut the program and claim it is reinforcement of their commitment. Perhaps BP stands for Beyond Prevarication or Beyond Pinocchio. Today, all this history, the story of Brown, of Hayward, and of BP, seems like a dress rehearsal for the main event. I'm referring, of course, to the catastrophic 2010 Gulf of Mexico oil spill. On the 20th of April, an explosion and fire on the Deepwater Horizon drilling rig killed 11 workers and injured 17 others. The rig sank, and the incident caused the wellhead on the ocean floor to start gushing oil. After numerous failed attempts, the oil flow was stopped for the first time with a temporary cap, 87 days and 184 million gallons, and one CEO later. Time will tell whether this temporary fix and the proposed permanent solution in the form of relief wells will prove conclusive. Understandably, at the time of writing, estimates of the scale and consequences of the disaster still vary considerably and will continue to change over time. However, on the 17th of July, the Guardian newspaper gathered the following numbers from the Associated Press and Friends of the Earth. $30 billion in cost to BP, including a $20 billion damages fund. 444 sea turtles and 1,387 birds found dead. 572 miles of shoreline oiled. 2,700 square miles of visible slick. 83,927 square miles closed to fishing. 1.82 million gallons of dispersant chemicals applied. And $336 million market value of the spilled oil. One number that is hard to forget is that BP's share price lost 50% of its value in 50 days. Not surprisingly, speculation was rife about whether the company would survive intact or whether it would be taken over, merged, or disaggregated. The lawsuits also started coming thick and fast. By 16th of June, it faced more than 225 lawsuits in 11 U.S. states. According to Bloomberg, investors in three states, including Louisiana and Alaska, have sued BP's board of directors for allegedly causing more than $50 billion in shareholder losses by failing to implement safety policies that would have prevented the spill. In a separate class action lawsuit in Florida, the company is accused of a pattern of criminal acts, including fraud. On the 16th of July, BP announced that it had already paid $201 million to more than 32,000 claimants, including fishermen who have received $32 million and shrimpers who have received $18 million. In addition, about $77 million has been paid for loss of income to a variety of occupations, including deckhands and employees of seafood processing plants and other businesses. The breaking news as I write this chapter is that BP admitted to using Photoshop to exaggerate oil spill command center activity. The oil spill has become a story that will run and run, like a snowball changing shape, gathering weight, and increasing destruction as it goes. Many questions for now remain unanswered. Will BP recover its reputation? Will the sacrifice of Hayward be enough to quench the bloodlust of critics? Will this be chalked up as the worst environmental disaster in history? Will we look back on the Macondo blowout as the inadvertent tipping point that ushers in a new low-carbon future? Students, professors, and CSR wonks will study this case for years to come, but for the purposes of this book and this chapter, it is simply the latest drama in the BP saga, the story of a corporate leader in the age of management that managed to become a poster for the age of marketing. Magic tricks and military tactics. Why is BP such a good example of the age of marketing, which is characterized by misdirection? Well, we must begin by asking what is meant by misdirection. Most commonly, it refers to a technique used when performing magic tricks. One hand distracts, often using a shiny object like a coin, while the other performs the deception. That is why we say the hand is quicker than the eye, and we are victims to a sleight of hand. In the movie Swordfish, the main character, Gabriel, reminds us that what the eyes see and the ears hear, the mind believes. A typical distraction method is to use a large gesture, like dramatic sweeping arm movements, to conceal a small gesture, like using a hand to quickly hide an object. One of the greatest modern maestros of misdirection is British TV celebrity illusionist Derren Brown. In his Trick of the Mind programs, he tells us that he achieves his results using a combination of magic, suggestion, psychology, misdirection, and showmanship. One of my favorite setups is where Brown simultaneously plays nine of Britain's top chess players, including two grandmasters. He seats them in a circle and makes a move against each player, one at a time, achieving a remarkable 4 wins, 3 losses, and 2 draws. Unbeknown to them, what he is really doing is remembering and mimicking the moves of players opposite each other. Hence, they were not playing him, but each other. In sports, we have misdirection in the form of the feint. In fencing and boxing, which involves attacking into one line with the intention of switching to another line before the attack is complete. Similarly, in American football, there is the counter tray, where the offensive team feigns rushing one way, then attacks the defense in the opposite direction. Also in rugby, we have the time-honored dummy pass or dummy runner. Apart from sport, history is also full of military examples of feint attacks and feint retreats used to deceive enemies. For example, during the Battle of Hastings, the Norman cavalry feigned retreat. As a result, the pursuing Saxons forfeited the advantage of height and the line was broken, providing the opportunity to fight in single-handed combat on a neutral vantage point. Another famous feint retreat is the Parthian shot, whereby the Parthian or ancient Iranian mounted archers would feign retreat, then at full gallop turn their bodies to face and shoot the chasing enemy. Not surprisingly, misdirection is also a favorite tool of government intelligence agencies. One popular tactic is called the limited hangout. Victor Marchetti, a former special assistant to the deputy director of the CIA, and author of Propaganda and Disinformation, How the CIA Manufactures History, explains it as follows. A limited hangout is spy jargon for a favorite and frequently used gimmick of the clandestine professionals. When their veil of secrecy is shredded, and they can no longer rely on a phony cover story to misinform the public, they resort to admitting, sometimes even volunteering, some of the truth, while still managing to withhold the key and damaging facts in the case. The public, however, is usually so intrigued by the new information that it never thinks to pursue the matter further. Criminals, of course, know misdirection well, especially pickpockets. Often working in teams, the pickpocket or their partners in crime will typically ask a question or bump into their victim to distract them from the thievery in progress. Dickens' timeless pickpocket Fagin, in the musical version of Oliver Twist, sings, "Dear old gent passing by, something nice takes his eye. Everything's clear, attack the rear, get in and pick a pocket or two." In misdirection, what is said is as important as what is done. Beyond simple lying, which is an all-too-common technique in and of itself, the use of psychobabble and technobabble has become especially rife. Psychobabble was coined by author and journalist Richard Dean Rosen in a 1975 New York Times cover story of the same title. Although it initially referred to the misuse of psychological terms, today it is generally used to mean jargon, buzzwords, and highly esoteric language used to give an impression of plausibility through mystification, misdirection, and obfuscation. Technobabble is used in a similar way in an attempt to create a pseudoscientific impression that will enhance credibility. Using smoke and mirrors. So much for the concept of misdirection. What about its application in business? The tobacco industry is a past master in the art of marketing-led deception. For years, as research of the negative health impacts of smoking piled up, the industry sponsored a campaign of disinformation and deception. Let's start with what we know about tobacco. According to the World Health Organization, no other consumer product is as dangerous or kills as many people. Tobacco kills more than AIDS, legal drugs, illegal drugs, road accidents, murder, and suicide combined. Of everyone alive today, 500 million will eventually be killed by smoking. And while 0.1 billion people died from tobacco use in the 20th century, 10 times as many will die from the same cause in the 21st century. This is not simply a health issue, but also an economic crisis. In America alone, smoking costs the economy $76 billion in health costs and lost productivity. Smoking-related diseases account for 6% of all health costs in the USA, and on average, a smoker takes 6.16 days of leave, as compared with 3.86 for non-smokers. Of all the trash collected in the US in 1996, cigarette butts accounted for 20%. There are indirect costs as well. Every year, 1 million fires are started by children using cigarette lighters. In 1997, China's worst forest fire was caused by cigarettes and killed 300 people, as well as making 5,000 homeless and destroying 1.3 million hectares of land. In 2000, fires caused by smoking reportedly cost $27 billion and killed 300,000 people. The debate about the ethics of industry-sponsored research and the practice of misdirection by Big Tobacco reached its zenith when in 1994, the CEOs of seven of America's largest tobacco companies testified before the House Subcommittee on Health and the Environment of Congress, all denying that cigarettes are addictive. They all lied under oath. 2 years later, an investigative article in Vanity Fair, entitled "The Man Who Knew Too Much," told the true story of Jeffrey Wigand, a research chemist working for the tobacco company, who planned to go on the 60 Minutes TV show to expose the lies and deception of the industry, including the CEOs that he labeled the Seven Dwarves. The story was later turned into the 1996 movie The Insider, starring Russell Crowe as Wigand, which was nominated for 7 Academy Awards and 5 Golden Globes. Asked in an interview to separate fact from fiction in the movie, Wigand replied, "Was I followed by an ex-FBI agent in the employ of Brown and Williamson? Yes. Was there a bullet found in my mailbox in January 1996? Yes. Did someone threaten to harm my family if I told the truth about the inner workings of the tobacco company I worked for? Yes. Did the tobacco industry attempt to undermine my integrity with a 500-page smear campaign? Yes." The industry took another public relations hit in 2005 with the release of the movie Thank You for Smoking. It is a satirical comedy that follows the machinations of Big Tobacco's chief spokesman, Nick Naylor, who engages in PR spin on behalf of cigarettes while trying to remain a role model for his 12-year-old son. Among the more amusing black humor scenes is one where Naylor and his friends, a firearm lobbyist and an alcohol lobbyist, meet every week and jokingly call themselves the Merchants of Death or the Mod Squad. Of course, Hollywood represents the lighter end of a far more serious and significant anti-tobacco lobby that has built momentum over the past two decades. We have simultaneously seen a United Nations World Health Organization campaign and numerous governments passing legislation restricting smoking in public places and banning nearly all forms of tobacco advertising. The tobacco companies themselves have been scrambling to regain their lost credibility and to present a more responsible face, seemingly with some success. For example, companies like British American Tobacco have engaged in extensive stakeholder consultation exercises, and since 2001, their businesses in more than 40 markets have produced social reports, many of which have won awards from organizations as diverse as the United Nations Environment Program, PricewaterhouseCoopers, and the Association of Certified Chartered Accountants. BAT has also been ranked in the Dow Jones Sustainability Index, the FTSE Ethical Bonus Index, and the Business in the Community Corporate Responsibility Index, and they funded Nottingham University's International Centre for CSR. If these accolades and associations are to be believed, responsible tobacco is not an oxymoron after all. Sowing the seeds of doubt. You might be forgiven for thinking that tobacco is an outlier. After all, no other industry, with the possible exception of armaments, kills people so systematically and publicly. Yet the tactics of misdirection are pervasive in businesses across all sectors. If anything, Big Tobacco simply served as inspiration for others to follow. For example, speaking about the climate change denial lobby, former U.S. Senator Tim Worth, who spearheaded environmental issues as an Undersecretary of State in the Clinton administration, concluded that they patterned what they did after the tobacco industry. Both figured, sow enough doubt and call the science uncertain and in dispute. That's had a huge impact on both the public and Congress. In a 2007 article for Newsweek called The Truth About Denial, Sharon Begley warned that outside Hollywood, Manhattan, and other habitats of the chattering classes, the denial machine is running at full throttle and continuing to shape both government policy and public opinion. Since the late 1980s, this well-coordinated, well-funded campaign by contrarian scientists, free market think tanks, and industry has created a paralyzing fog of doubt around climate change. Through advertisements, op-eds, lobbying, and media attention, greenhouse doubters, they hate being called deniers, argued first that the world is not warming. Measurements indicated otherwise are flawed, they said. Then they claimed that any warming is natural, not caused by human activities. Now they contend that the looming warming will be minuscule and harmless. This denial machine found a contemporary home in the previously mentioned Global Climate Coalition. The coalition, comprising mainly of US companies with vested interests in the status quo, including virtually all of the large chemical, oil, and motor companies, was set up in 1989 after the first Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report, ostensibly to coordinate business participation in the international policy debate on the issue of global climate change and global warming. Translation: to lobby against the emerging consensus of climate science and policy development, brought about by the IPCC, comprising around 2,500 of the world's most respected scientists, and the Kyoto Protocol, signed and ratified by 187 states, excluding the USA. Apart from funding and highlighting any studies that sowed doubt in the public and political mind, the Global Climate Coalition distributed documents and videos raising concerns about the economic impacts of climate action and the potential benefit of global warming for agricultural yields. They also sponsored the Global Climate Information Project, which ran anti-Kyoto Protocol advertising, saying, "It's not global and it won't work, and Americans will pay the price, 50 cents more for every gallon of gasoline." It is perhaps not surprising that among the Global Climate Coalition's PR spin doctors were Stephen Milloy, who, according to investigative journalist George Monbiot, was first funded by tobacco company Philip Morris, and Bruce Harrison, ironically considered the founder of Green PR because of his work for the pesticide industry in the 1960s, when he helped lead the attack on author Rachel Carson and her critical treatise, Silent Spring. Although the Global Climate Coalition became defunct in 2002, once its members realized that public and political opinion was turning against them, climate denial is far from over. A 2007 report by the Union of Concerned Scientists, entitled Smoke, Mirrors and Hot Air, documents how ExxonMobil adopted the tobacco industry's disinformation tactics, as well as some of the same organizations and personnel, to cloud the scientific understanding of climate change and delay action on the issue. According to the report, ExxonMobil funneled nearly $16 million between 1998 and 2005 to a network of 43 advocacy organizations that seek to confuse the public on the global warming science. Hanging greenwashing out to dry. While many of these examples, and I could cite countless more from the automotive, agricultural, chemical, and other industries, represent little more than the familiar toxic mix of old-fashioned dirty lobby tactics, many companies today are engaged in far more subtle and seemingly plausible campaigns of misdirection, investing in environmental management systems, producing sustainability reports, and performing supply chain audits. Each of these actions is, on its own merits, laudable and to be encouraged, applauded even. But all too often, they are used as a smokescreen to mask the more damaging impacts and irresponsible practices of business. Behind these actions lies a pervasive driver. According to the United Nations Global Compact and Accenture's 2010 CEO survey, three corporate attributes, brand, trust, and reputation, were consistently cited by CEOs as their primary reason for acting on sustainability. Other drivers that were unrelated to PR were cited only half as much, namely the potential for revenue growth and cost reduction, cited by 44%, personnel motivation, 42%, consumer and customer demand, 39%, and employee engagement and retention, 31%. What's more, 48% of CEOs cited competing strategic priorities as a barrier to their sustainability efforts. As we saw in the BP case, greenwash has become one of the more popular labels applied to PR-driven misdirection by companies on environmental issues. The word was coined by environmentalist David Bellamy in the 1980s and plays off of the concept of whitewashing, literally painting over the cracks to cover up inherent faults. In 1999, the Oxford English Dictionary added the term, defining it as disinformation disseminated by an organization so as to present an environmentally responsible public image. A public image of environmental responsibility promulgated by or for an organization, but perceived as being unfounded or intentionally misleading. José López, Executive Vice President of Operations at Nestlé, admits that, and I quote, "There's probably out there an environment for pretenders, for the greenwashers. It's going to get harder and harder to tell apart the greenwasher from the real guy." The reason is we have a lot of information on what constitutes good sustainability practice. In other words, it's easier to copy apparently credible behavior. One classic example was an advertisement run by Shell, which has a picture of a factory with flowers coming out of the smokestacks and claiming, "We use our waste carbon dioxide to grow flowers." There was a grain of truth in the claim. In the Netherlands, the company did capture carbon dioxide and use it in floral hothouses. However, since Shell only used 0.325% of its carbon dioxide this way, the Advertising Standards Authority banned the advertisement following complaints. As a result of this kind of greenwash, the UK's Committee on Advertising Practice Code, enforced by the Advertising Standards Authority, created a clause for environmental claims in 1995. Since 1998, it has also published a non-binding Green Claims Code, advising advertisers on how best to make good claims. Despite this, greenwashing complaints, the majority of which are upheld, continue to rise year on year. One rather fun yet informative publication is the Greenwash Guide by Futera. It lists 10 signs of greenwash, which include, first, fluffy language, words or terms with no clear meaning, such as eco-friendly. Second, green products versus a dirty company, such as efficient light bulbs made in a factory which pollutes rivers. Third, suggestive pictures, green images that indicate an unjustified green impact, such as flowers blooming from exhaust pipes. Fourth, irrelevant claims, emphasizing one tiny green attribute when everything else is ungreen. Fifth, best in class, declaring you are slightly greener than the rest, even if the rest are pretty terrible. Six, just not credible. Eco-friendly cigarettes, anyone? Greening a dangerous product doesn't make it safe. Seven, gobbledygook, jargon and information that only a scientist could check or understand. Eight, imaginary friends, a label that looks like third-party endorsement, except it's made up. 9. No proof. It could be right, but where is the evidence? And finally, 10. Outright lying, total fabricated claims or data. Of course, this kind of misdirection does not only apply to environmental issues. After the launch of the UN Global Compact, companies started to be accused of blue wash, a reference to the blue United Nations logo, and businesses using association with the UN to appear more responsible than they really are. Likewise, although I haven't heard the term, I can imagine the redwash brush being applied to companies claiming social, community or labour responsibility that masks their real negative impacts on society. The invisible hand of marketing. It is not hard to see why a lot of the blame for misdirection gets laid on the marketing function in companies, especially corporate communications, advertising, and public relations departments. A survey by the Institute of Business Ethics of 60 codes of ethics from a range of sectors and countries showed that 48% do not mention marketing or give any guidance to staff on what responsible, values-led marketing might be. The Marketing Society talks about the creation of customer-led demand in their definition of marketing, which is another way of saying artificially stimulated needs, or more often, wants or greeds. Examples of manipulation are not hard to come by. In 1990, Volvo ran a television advertisement that showed a monster truck driving over a line of cars. Only the Volvo escaped unscathed, and for good reason. All of the other cars had been sabotaged and the Volvo had been reinforced. When the misrepresentation came to light, Volvo earned itself a $300,000 fine from the state of Texas and had to publish a corrective statement in the Wall Street Journal. In 2002, Sony Ericsson paid 60 actors to pose as fake tourists in New York and ask passers-by to help them to operate the new camera phone, while they extolled its virtues and never disclosed their commercial relationship with the company. In another version, actresses were hired to generate interest in their phones by playing an interactive version of the game of battleships at either end of a bar. The scam was eventually exposed by the Wall Street Journal and the 60 Minutes television program. Actors were also hired by McDonald's in Japan, 1,000 of them, to pose as customers queuing outside a store for a newly launched burger. The idea was to create a contagion of interest and excitement, but once again, their link to the company was not revealed. This is now known as stealth marketing and is widely condemned as unethical and manipulative. Of course, it becomes more difficult to police in the age of YouTube, as a stealth advertisement by Australian brand Witchery showed. An actress posted a video claiming to be on a romantic quest to find a mystery man she met in a restaurant who left his jacket behind. Needless to say, the video generated a real buzz with over 200,000 hits before it was revealed as a viral marketing campaign to highlight the company's expansion of its clothing line, previously only for women, to include men. It was all about the jacket and nothing to do with the fictitious romance. Clever? Sure. Misdirection? Absolutely. From misdirection to redirection. The age of marketing is summed up by a 2006 statement by Ben Verwaayen, who was CEO of the telecommunications giant BT at the time. He said, "Until now, corporate social responsibility has been seen in many companies as something which has to be done, a box which needs to be ticked, in all too many cases, without much enthusiasm." This is a view echoed by editor Daniel Franklin in The Economist's World in 2009 yearbook. He says, "Many companies pretend that their sustainability strategy runs deeper than it really does. It has become almost obligatory for executives to claim that CSR is connected to the core of corporate strategy, or that it has become part of the DNA. In truth, even ardent advocates of sustainability struggle to identify more than a handful of examples. More often, the activities that go under the sustainability banner are a hodgepodge of pet projects, at best tenuously related to the core business." What we need, therefore, is less misdirection and more redirection towards genuine corporate sustainability and responsibility. A step in the right direction is the adoption of strategic CSR, although, as we have seen from BP's example, this can also be manipulated as a form of promotional CSR. It is therefore to the age of management that we now turn our attention.